In the first two videos, I talked about how to balance our soil fertility so that we can grow the kind of plants that we want to grow, and then also how to learn from nature to bring organic matter into our gardens. The third video is about the soil food web, and that's really about the organisms living in the soil, whereas organic matter was more about when they're dead, when plants and animals and organisms are dead. This is more about when they're living. So it's bacteria and fungi and earthworms and insects and animals, and even the plants are part of the soil food web too. If you had X-ray microscopic vision and could look down into the soil here, you would see a web of fungi that are going between all of these different trees and attaching the trees together. What the fungi do is they effectively extend the root system of the trees, and they go deep into the soil and far out into the soil. They bring water and nutrients to the trees. They also wrap right around the roots. That's where the connection occurs, and they protect the roots from plant feeding organisms. And then the trees in return, they manufacture carbohydrates during photosynthesis, and they send that carbohydrate down to the fungi as food. So it's a real bartering system. Even if you don't have microscopic vision, although I can't see any right now, you can sometimes see the fruits of these fungi, which are mushrooms. So the mushrooms come up, and that's kind of the fruits, and that's one way that the fungi spread themselves. Even more interesting to me than that barter, although that's really cool, is that the trees can actually share probably water, certainly nutrition, and probably even knowledge with each other through this fungal network. So they send things through the fungi to each other to help each other out. And then there are bacteria in the soil, there are protists in the soil. They all have slightly different roles, but they all do important things for the community, and they're very interdependent. They all consume each other and relate to each other and sometimes help each other. Some of the things they do are they feed plants, they protect plants, they break down organic matter. So they take that mulch that falls from the trees or the animals or everything that's dead, they turn it into a kind of a mulch and then eventually into a humus. They take some of them, take nitrogen from the air and convert it into a form that plants can use. Some of them take toxins in the soil and make them not toxic anymore. Any kind of role that we need in our human communities happens in the plant communities. Taking out the garbage and being the doctors and all things like that, there's all different roles that organisms have to play in the soil. In the forest, the conditions are pretty nice for these microorganisms, for these fungi and bacteria and all these little guys. It's pretty good. In our gardens, often not so much. We've had a lot of maybe construction work in our gardens. Maybe we have a lot of compaction from equipment, lawnmowers, kids running around and playing soccer. We have monocultures that the lack of diversity causes issues. Maybe someone has used chemical fertilizers or pesticides in the past, which really decimates that soil food web. And so in our gardens, we may not have as abundant of a soil food web, as healthy, as diverse of a soil food web as naturally occurs here in the forest. So in our gardens, we may need to do something to introduce this microbial diversity back into our soil. The first way, and arguably definitely one of the best ways to do it, is compost, which I talked about in the organic matter section. A lot of people know compost is organic matter, which is good. It's nutrients, which are good, but it's also just as important. It's a way of growing and multiplying beneficial aerobic microorganisms, bacteria and fungi. If you have good compost that smells good, that was made properly, then you have good beneficial organisms that you can bring into your garden and inoculate your garden with those organisms. So that's the one thing to do, but we don't usually have as much compost around, especially good compost, as we'd like. And so in that case, there are other things you can do, either to supplement the compost, or even if you don't have compost, to bring these microbes into your garden. I started off this post talking about mycorrhizal fungi that are in the forest here. You may very well not have them in all that, in abundance in your garden. And so there are ways that you can propagate them from healthy tree roots, but you have to know a lot, about how to do that properly. It takes some time. For me, the best thing to do is just to go and buy a small amount of them. You can buy them as an inoculant. And then every time you are seeding or planting anything, you put a little bit of fungi on the roots or on the seeds, and you're going to get them into your soil that way. Other ways, you can culture lactic acid bacteria, which is something that's a very useful bacteria for your soil. But again, to me, and I like doing the homemade stuff, but sometimes it makes sense, there's a mosquito in front of the lens, sometimes it makes sense to buy a product. So there's a product called Effective Microorganisms. You can buy it for usually $15 to $30, depending on what kind you get. Bring that into your soil. It's going to bring a bunch of different fermenting microbes, including but not limited to lactic acid bacteria. And they're going to provide many benefits to your garden, to your soil, to your compost pile, and to your plants. Another one is compost tea. It's a little more work to make a good compost tea, but if you can do it, what you're doing there is you're bringing in a huge array of tens of thousands of different species of microorganisms into your soil. Whereas the EM is just a few really important microbes, compost tea is many different microbes. And the cool thing about the EM, which is effective microorganisms, and the compost tea is you can also spray them onto your plants and inoculate the leaves where they can feed the plant right through the leaf and protect the plants from diseases like that leaf seems to have. So compost is the best, but there are other ways that we can bring in these inoculants into the garden. Of course, we also need to stop the tilling of our soil, which is hard on microorganisms, the compacting, the chemical use, the pesticide use, and we also have to make sure we provide them with a good home. So that means we need to water the whole soil, not just drip irrigation to the plants. We need to give water to all these microorganisms. We need to give them mulch, a nice leaf layer and organic matter in the soil. We need to do what I talked about in the first video, which is balance out the nutrients just to make sure they have the proper nutrient ratios in the soil. So we need to do all the things I've been talking about, we need to do not just for the plants, but for all of these organisms in the soil. Okay, we've made it back to our cabin alive, although we do have some bites on our legs. But I hope you've enjoyed these three videos. In the Smiling Gardener Academy, I get into a lot of these inoculants, how to activate your own EM so that it really brings the cost down to like $1 to $2 per liter, how to make a special kind of compost called bokashi with EM, how to brew your own compost tea, how to get your own indigenous lactic acid bacteria. So all kinds of cool inoculants to improve the soil food web, and of course composting too. The price, as I said, goes up Monday night. So if you're thinking about that, maybe have a look at it. Other than that, I hope you enjoyed it.